Hey everyone, how's it going? Welcome back to Let's Play Kingsfield for the Ancient City. Today, we're not going to finish the game in one mega-long sitting. I had kind of toyed with that idea, so we could smoothly transition from the end of Ancient City into Dark Souls 3, but it would just be a bad time all around. And we're getting a bit deeper into the part of the Ancient City that I really like, so I'm gonna try to just not wolf it all down at once. What we will do today is venture out into a couple of brand new areas, unlike anything that we've touched so far in the game. And first, before we do that, we'll take some time and open up a big shortcut and explore a little bit more of this middle section of the ziggurat. And if it means that we have to corral some xenomorphs using a door and some questionable AI, then goddammit, we're gonna do that. So come through. Nah, you're gonna shoot that fireball? That's cool. Come through that door, though. The door is your friend. You wanna come through there? Great, you've sprung my trap. You've now triggered my door trap. Good job. The trick is that their AI and pathing is terrible. Yeah, look at him go. He just wants to get back to his home. It's actually kind of sad. Just a little bit, though. Okay, so we clear that room out. The red xenomorph threat is abated for the time being. Now, we will slowly swing away and slash at these faces on the wall who are regurgitating lava. Although, if you look closely, while you can see the lava animate a tiny bit, it certainly does not look like it's flowing. It more looks like one kind of static image with where the texture just moves a little bit. It doesn't look like anything particularly resembling lava or any kind of liquid. Sonic 06, and this is not a fair comparison, Sonic 06 at least had the decency to make their lava just recolored water. But the technical marvels you can achieve at the beginning of the 360 gen. Lava water. Also herbal liquid. This guy is tracing a map of the ancient city in the ground with his lance. You don't seem like a monster. I'm not sure how I got here. The place you can see through that window is most likely the south side of the city. This knight knows his shit. I came to this place, the ancient city, once I ended my services as a palace knight in my homeland. I was in constant battle, and I couldn't embrace the quiet life. This character, who we don't even know the name of, is already getting more characterization than anyone else so far. I think a map is going to be necessary. I heard that the infamous thief Zastari left a map of the city here, but I haven't found it. Zastari is one of the few names we are going to hear recur. But that's about all he has to say for the time being. I think we can revisit him down the line. Speaking of Zastari, actually, we are going to hear that name again once I open up a shortcut that I just somehow completely forgot about before. I don't know if I'm going to get around to it yet, but it's actually a very important, it's a very important shortcut that leads back to the top of the ziggurat that I just missed last time. It's another door in that mausoleum back in the castle, the one where all the skeletons attacked. I think I was just in such a rush to not deal with getting flanked by dozens of arrows that I just kind of forgot about hitting the door to open the shortcut up. We'll circle back to that at some point. Here we go. Welcome to my workshop. I'd like to welcome you in a more elaborate fashion, but please forgive my impoliteness at this time. That's no problem. Now that I've finally completed my finest work, I must hurry and deliver it to the battlefront. The arrogant act of the cursed dark folk shall now come to an end. The only thing that concerns me is the whereabouts of our king. If you happen to see him, please tell him about me. I will come for you when I get back. I'll come right now, Jody. So first off, we are going to break all of this man's barrels. That door at the moment is locked. We'll unlock that momentarily. We just have one more barrel to break. I need a mushroom before I can light that. This sconch, you'll notice, is unlit. And it might seem unassuming, but if you light it with a fireball, it opens that previously locked door. And inside the chest in this room is a map. And this happens to be a very useful map, because this is the Earthfolk map. It's a map for an area that we have not visited yet, but it's an area that we're going to get to momentarily. And unlike the other map that we got earlier, it's actually usable. So having it around is quite the boon. And now climbing down here, there should be a fire trap. Yeah. There's a dragon spewing fire, and it's gonna go on and off intermittently. So I'm gonna go down two rungs and wait. And we're good. Okay. And now we just strafe right. Okay. And plenty of time. I'm not 100% sure what that opens up. I guess we'll find out later, because we will be back here. There's a craftsman's chest. We know that we need that key. There was the Sirach's chest, the priest chest, the engineer's chest, and the craftsman's chest back in the forest. Plus, we've been encountering those doors here and there. We do have the priest key now. By the end of this, I think we should have the craftsman's key. It's the engineer or the craftsman? I think it's the craftsman's key by the end of this. So our kind of long-term goal is going to be to collect those four keys, open the chests up back in the forest. Plus, there are a number of doors and chests that are scattered along the way that we'll need to backtrack to, because they also require those keys. The gate that we just opened up should look familiar. It's a gate back out into the ancient city, where we entered the ancient city in the first place. So we've opened up a really major shortcut. Now we get to go on and progress. Oh, hey, guy. Yeah, we'll use the same door trick. Trick him into coming here. Can't open the door, so it's very hard for him to run around. And his AI, all he wants to do is go back home. So yeah, we'll take advantage of that. Probably the easiest way to deal with those enemies, because it's hard to out-circle strafe them. U-turn more slowly than they can circle strafe you. Again, it's gotta be... It makes you sympathize with the Dark Souls bosses a bit, because they circle strafe you and you cannot keep up. Also, apologies for the last episode of this that went up. The sync on the last Kingsfield was fucked. So let me sum that one up in case you skipped it because of the bad syncing early on. We visited Drangleic Castle, and oh god, the status ailments. We got afflicted by all of them. And not little baby status ailments, like, oh no, poison. No, we got the bad ones. We got stun. We got blindness, which you might think would affect your accuracy. Nope! Makes you blind. Turns your screen dark. It just takes that brightness slider and whoop, all the way to the left. We're not gonna give these things a chance to start spitting goo all over the place. Stun them with one foot. Wow, that's a lot of gold for some plants. Send them one fireball, take them out with a swing follow-up. If you get too close, they spit out, I think, paralyzing toxin. And paralysis... honestly, I fear it less than stun. Stun, I think, is more inconvenient, even though paralysis freezes you in your spot. That's easier to cure, and it doesn't last as long. Also, these things that we encountered for the first time in Drangleia Castle, they can also inflict paralysis on you, although they don't seem to do it too often. There are a bunch of outlets from this cave that we can explore, but there's no sense going in them yet. First thing that we want to do is come over here to the hallway with all of the dragon statues. And then once we finish clearing out the demons, we'll hang that left. Because there's a little key I want to get before I start exploring all of these different rooms, only some of which hold any kind of treasure. I know there's one more. How the hell did he just wander off and stay there? Oh, and he's wandering even further? The direction we're facing right now is where we want to go to long-term in this episode. That's going to be the next area over there. And I might as well just take a little jaunt over here. And where is it? There should be a new type of pill bug. This is a frozen pill bug. He can leap much further, I think, than the other ones, but also he has an ice breath. And I'm gonna need a little bit of room to maneuver, so I don't want to get sandwiched between him and may you slumber in peace amidst the flames. Him and all of the enemies up in this graveyard coming up. These are all tombstones, and they seem to be either earth folk or forest folk tombstones. And they let you know that just by visual differentiation between those and the tombstones in the graveyards we've already been in. Oh, so I was talking about the last episode. And things that you may have missed out on if you skipped through the last one. Another thing that I was talking about in the last episode was the ramp up that we've seen in recently in level complexity, something that's going to get a little bit more emphatic this time. Something else that you'll notice has ramped up and is going to continue to ramp up is difficulty. They're throwing more enemies at a time at you, the enemies are getting a little bit faster, which completely upends the flow of combat with how slow you are. Status effects are coming into play much more frequently, and much nastier status effects are starting to afflict us. Traps are becoming more dangerous. It's getting a little bit suffocating, but it happened pretty gradually, if you noticed. They give you time to acclimate to the really funky controls and the very deliberate pace. Then they start throwing a couple new enemies at you, a couple new challenges. Once you hit the ancient city, they give you a break in the cavern below the forest, some time to really catch your breath, because there's nothing too challenging down there. And then it's off to the most difficult area by a long shot so far, the castle. And you can plot the pacing of that pretty well. That nice up and down ramping of tension and release. Along with that difficulty curve, which is what I'm really interested in talking about. And speaking of that, this is something from the cutting room floor of that recent Tiny Voices episode I did about, it should be the one, right? Yeah, it's the one way in the back. There it is. There's no visual indicator that it's on that tombstone. But that is the key that we'll need. Yeah, I was saying, that recent Tiny Voices episode that I did about bugs that become features, Space Invaders, is something that I was going to bring up in that episode. You might be thinking, what do Space Invaders have to do with Kingsfield? They couldn't be more different, right? But one owes a lot to the other, and that element is the difficulty curve. Space Invaders was doing difficulty curves when games were in their infancy. 1978, Space Invaders comes out. You start off and it's like shooting fish in a barrel, right? It's easy. Then over time, the alien ships start moving in their zigzags a lot faster. They get faster and faster. And meanwhile, you don't get the same benefit. You never get any faster. Your projectiles travel the same rate. And suddenly you have to lead them and predict their pathing a lot more accurately, because they aren't just sitting still for you. It's simple, it's challenging, it's satisfying. You have to lead them and be a lot more precise with where you place your shots. And it is one of gaming's first proper difficulty curves. And it was a total fluke. The cabinets at the time didn't have the sophisticated enough hardware to move the alien ships at the speed that they were intended to move at. So as you shot them down, processing power was being freed up, because there were less things on the screen to have to process and apply physics to. Or rather, pathing. Not really physics. Never awake the sealed one. Where was I going with that? Oh man, I lost my train of thought reading that message. Shit. The ships weren't moving, with all of the ships on the screen, they weren't moving at the speed they were intended to move at. So as you shot them down and processing power was freed up, they would start to speed up. Rather, they weren't being slowed down as much by the bogged down processor. And the creator recognized that it actually created this exhilarating feeling as you played it more and more, and gradually became better at mastering this ramp up in difficulty. So we just left it like that. So every time you think of how nice a good difficulty curve feels, that feeling of gradually mastering a game that's slowly getting harder over time, pay some respects to Space Invaders, because that game was a marvel of accidental innovation. Now that we picked up a pretty decent amount of stuff here, I don't think I'm gonna need to do too much more exploration. I think there are maybe a couple of minor things that I could still get, but nothing really worth the hassle of fighting off a ton more xenomorphs or anything like that. So I feel like I'm pretty well decked out. Let's save real quick just in case the worst should happen. Bum, bum, bum. And then we can get a move on into a really terrible, from a visual standpoint, a really terrible environment. Design-wise, I love it, but you'll see. It makes my eyes bleed. In very much the same way the Isolith did, actually. It's not the incredibly dark areas that get you. It's the ones that are blindingly bright. How did he get back up? Did he just crawl up the stairs? I guess when I got far enough away, the game reset his position, because it figured he's not supposed to be down there. Okay, so ready for the forge? God, it's a white abyss. And this is where our Earthfolk map becomes relevant, because it actually shows an arrow marking where the player is. Holy shit, Hyper Light Drifter can learn a lesson from this game. It's one of the most useless maps I've ever seen in a game, and it's got more problems than just the one I'm alluding to. Anyway, the Frozen Craftsman's Forge. Oh, I can't out-circle strafe the pill bug anymore? Come on. So most enemies at this stage are going to be kind of weak to fire, which is why we have the Fire Carver on. At the moment, it's not going to be worth exploring. We want to try to take the straightest path out of here. Because what we have to do is get lava flowing into the forge so that we can heat everything up, so that we can dispel this horrendous brightness. Ah, hey. These ice golems are pretty cool. They are kung fu ice warriors. Come on, show me some of your moves. Yeah! Look how stiff the animation looks. I mean, he's a big ice sculpture, so you gotta bear with it a little bit. Just one of the worst looking environments by far. Frozen Izalith. You have two extremes. You have the xenomorphs blinding you in the last level with their dark balls. And then you have this frozen forge glowing like the sun. I know snow blindness is actually a thing, but there's nothing to, there's no light source in here for the, all the ice and the snow to reflect. Jesus. It's laughable. It's a shame because the idea behind this area is really cool and the layout is fantastic. These two are being kind of nice. We've hit their bounding box a little bit. And then between the fireball and the fire carver, they don't actually take all that much to kill. Fire carver is a little bit tricky against these enemies because of its short range, though. Oh god, I couldn't see him for a sec. It's just disappearing into the abyss. Ah. It'd be nice if you could more accurately predict whether or not they're going to do the single punch or the three-hit combo that ends in that forward kick. But it's no problem. Yeah, that's not where we need to be yet. You can see a boss is frozen in there. We'll be having some words with him once we thaw the forge out. That's what I love about this area, is it's actually a lot like a Lamb Loist the first time through, how you have to get the wind stopping, you have to stop the wind, and that thaws out a bunch of a Lamb Loist, and then you backtrack, you double through your tracks, and discover a whole bunch of new pathways. That's actually kind of identical to how this area works, except you're not stopping howling frigid winds. You're just getting the flow of lava back into the forge, which accomplishes essentially the same thing. It thaws out a bunch of new pathways. It actually blocks off and creates new pathways. So it changes how you navigate and where you can navigate to, and also which enemies inhabit the area. So that bridge that we knocked down creates a shortcut back to the beginning of the forge area. And we're making good progress through. This actually isn't a very big level. I mean, it's sprawling, but it's pretty tight and compact. Which is hard to really see. It's hard to tell. Because, you know, vision. Ah, no. I stepped into the wrong neighborhood. That's my bad. There were three of them. I almost missed this. What's this? The shield? Oh no, this is the ice rapier. No, I'm thinking of Dark Souls again. That is... the lethal rapier, if I remember right. Which has no ancillary stats other than just pure thrust damage. So it's really good at one thing and one thing only. I'm not particularly sure what is weak to just thrust damage, so. Might have occasion to use that rapier later, but not now. In the depths of the Cavern of Heat, lies an altar of ice. Using the rule of nature, it controls the flow of heat. It's a lot of proper nouns. But yeah, tablets telling us a general idea of how we want to solve this area. Look how far the pill bugs leap now. We want to use the rule of nature on the altar of ice to get the flow of heat going again. And yeah, that's the forge. Now we come out into this this branched pathway into the caves, and this is going to be more of a lava cavern. This entire little tributary bed is going to be flowing with lava by the time we're done with this, but for the time being, we can actually follow it and go up this hill to this chest, where we get the Ring of Fire. And I went down, 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 and the flames went higher, and it burns, 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 the Ring of Fire. Ring of Fire, really handy to have here. Because as you can imagine, we're going to be running into a bunch of fire enemies. Including these guys, who you saw for a minute in the periphery. I was right in the middle of a fucking reptile zoo. Somebody was giving booze to these goddamn things. It won't be long now before they tear us to shreds. What do I actually want to use? Where's my frostbite that we picked up earlier? There we go, this cool-looking blue sword with a whole bunch of ice damage. Should be the best option. I'm not even sure that hit him. Man, I wanted to try using something other than fireball on him, but the MP cost of that, plus the fact that it didn't appear to hit. Maybe it wasn't worth it. Maybe I should just save all that mana for Earth Heal. Then again, the more Earth Heal and the more Earth spells I use, including Upheaval, it'll level my Earth spells up faster, so that's one benefit. It'd give me a higher level Earth Heal. Ah, shit. Okay, so we're just gonna do this dance with this goddamn reptile. Good thing I at least have the frostbite. Ah! What killed the dinosaurs? The Ice Age. I think this is where I want to head. Oh, hey. That one doesn't want to breathe fire at me. So that's going to be a little bit harder to deal with, huh? Why don't we check that map? Okay, so this terminates on the left, and I think there's an item you pick up over here. Ooh, how nice! He charged right into the edge of his pathing. Cool, I'll take that. I don't mind fighting these enemies one-on-one. One-on-one, they're pretty easy. If you, like this. If you let them start chaining that headbutt, that charging headbutt, over and over, they can get a little dangerous. They suck. They are some of the worst enemies to fight in pairs. And the even bigger problem is, not only do you fight them in pairs very often in this cavern, you fight them in pairs of pairs. You fight them like 3, 4, 5 at a time, and it's a little difficult to draw them out and pull them so that you have less to fight at a time. Rule of thumb in Kingsfield, this was kind of true in Dark Souls, but it is doubly, triply so in Kingsfield. Any enemy type that you're fighting in groups of two or more, it's gonna go really bad for you. Any time you get the opportunity to pull enemies apart from their packs, do it. It is very worth. Fuck, what is hitting me? Did one of them? Oh yeah, one of them wandered outside of their little designated zone. Like, Bloodborne is the first time you really had the mobility to handle big groups of enemies. Dark Souls 2 is when they started trying to throw, like, large groups of enemies at you, and those were some of the harder enemy encounters. Like, the one that I'm specifically thinking of in Dark Souls 2 is the one in the Bastille, where you have, like, a half dozen of those really strong Forsaken Knights. The motherfuckers. Ooh. Oh no, I fell into the lava bed. The dormant lava bed. That's okay. We can handle this. In fact, that might give me a chance to reset the whole situation, so it's probably not even that bad. Bing bing bong ba, bing 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 bong ba. Okay. This was the one that with the crystal axe, right? They call it a crystal axe, but it's basically one of the few halberds in this. Come on. If I have to lame it out against them like this, I will do it, because they are prone to killing me 2-on-1. This might do me a little bit of good. Not sure exactly how much of a benefit I'm reaping from using the frostbite against them. I'm assuming it's doing good bonus damage, but maybe the raw power of the bastard sword can outshine that. Oop. Come on. Well, it doesn't recharge nearly as quickly, and it doesn't appear to be speeding the fight up. So I don't know if it's worth it just yet. Yeah, even full power swings with Bastard Sword, which is two-handed even. Not getting the job done. Don't have access to your shield and all of the extra defensive stats. We'll experiment around and we'll see if the crystal axe actually does me some good here. That might be the slowest weapon we have. Well, that's not good data. Attacking this guy. We want this data. How many hits until you die to this crystal axe? Give me your data. I'm trying to download from you, my reptilian friend. Preparing to download packet of... Nah. Hold on. Preparing to download packet of data. Data inconclusive. What else we got? We can try that lethal rapier out. Maybe they take bonus thrust damage. At this point, I'm just trying to figure out what is most effective against these guys, or what will minimize the amount of time that I have to fight them. I had already done so much damage with other weapons that I'm not sure if the lethal rapier was actually what did it. Well, we have plenty of dinosaurs up ahead, which I'm gonna try to avoid fighting, because it's not particularly worth it. So, we can get some data out of this. Let's see what this tablet says. Fire, the heat that melts all, please protect us. We saw an inscription like that once before, except it was more of a plea, or a prayer, even, to, the forest. One was praying to the forest, now one is praying to the fire. Okay. kind of gives you some insight into the, like, the division in society between, like, the earth folk and the forest folk and what they worship. Took me a little while to get back here. I have not been saving frequently enough. And, round one against this guy didn't go so well. But this time I'm gonna take a more proactive approach to clearing his ads out, so hopefully I don't get harassed by them quite so much. Smelter Demon fell off the wagon here. Ah, poor Smelter Demon. Actually looks a lot like the Golgothan Shit Demon. And, he is damming up the flow of lava. So that's why we need to come back here and kill him. And this guy, he's kind of like our first real boss. Feels like it, anyway. I mean, I guess you could count the giant spider. But the giant spider feels more like just a big, unique version of an other enemy type. Doesn't actually feel like a proper boss fight, did he? This guy, on the other hand, a little bit closer to an actual boss. Spawns little mini smelters, tosses them out, has a little punch that he does, and fire breath. And he can be quite annoying. We'll just keep whacking away at him with frostbite. Eventually he'll keel over, and the flow of lava into the forge will start up again, which is our whole goal in killing him. We want lava to be flowing into the forge. Ah. Not doing an ideal job avoiding his stuff, but this is still, even ugly as this is, it's going better than the first fight. It's not entirely feasible to keep up with his ad spawns while still doing damage to him. I guess one thing you could do is clear the ads with a melee weapon, since they only take one hit anyway, and just reserve magic for him. But I don't have very good offensive magic at this stage in the game, and I'm not sure there's anything I could really have done about that. I think there's a wind-based spell that might have been good for him. Well, that was still not too much of a hassle. It's more of a hassle that he killed me the first go around, forced me to do all that backtracking. Speaking of backtracking, though, with the Golgothan dead. Oh, hey, bat. Hey. Or mini dragon. So used to calling them bats now, because they're just pests. Rats with wings. Rats that happen to shoot fireballs in volleys. We'll come up here now. There's no reason to actually come up here yet, except to see a new area. To get a little preview of it. So this is the Altar of Ice that was alluded to in an inscription earlier on. We don't have the item that we need yet. The icon can only be touched by a child of the forest. Death awaits all others. So we actually need the icon of ice to place upon the altar. The icon being like this rule of nature that the tablet alluded to. And with that, we can alter the environment inside the forge one more time, because even though the flow of lava is no longer ceased, we still have a problem. Ooh, we have actually big problems, because I didn't clear as many of the dinosaurs out as I did before. So we gotta be very careful. I am feeling a little bit underpowered. I'm definitely underleveled by just a tad bit. It's not game-breaking, but a couple of those enemies I've been skipping, it's starting to add up. I'm maybe one or two, maybe even three levels behind where I maybe should be. Which, again, while it's not game-breaking, it is a little bit more of an impediment than it is if you were, say, underleveled in a Souls game, especially by a similarly small amount. And I gotta turn around coming in here. Actually, can I come out this way? Yeah, this works. Oh, yeah, because it circles around that giant chunk of stone in the center. Okay. And once more into the forge. And you can see just by the color of the door, it's already a lot different in here. It's no longer blindingly white. It is, actually lit now, properly, by all the fire and the embers coming off of the forge. So we not only assume a warmer hue in here, all of the ice is melted, which gives us access to new stuff, but we, like I said, I'm riding on top of the pill bug. That's goofy. We still have one more problem. The lava flowing is actually a little too intense. It's actually too hot in here now. So first, the forge was too cold, and now it's too hot, so we have to get it into that Goldilocks zone. You'll notice the ice bridge is melted now. That ice bridge is what let us cross over on the top floor of the central forge room before. Oh, hell. I'm getting nibbled on by pill bugs, aren't I? Also, the pill bugs no longer can breathe ice at us. And instead of using the fire carver, we're gonna default to the frostbite now. So yeah, the intense blow of lava in here, along with all the embers and stuff coming off of the forge, still creating a problem for us, but it's opened up a couple of new pathways. It's opened up that frozen boss fight, the giant, the big Viking bastard. He is now available for us to fight. Also, the shortcut is now available to us. The shortcut that leads directly back to the save room. This door, I want to say, is now... Yeah, this door is open now because it was frozen over before, but there's still a bunch of lava flowing in here. So we have to cease the flow of lava just a little bit. Or we have to find some way to cool this place down. You have to put it in the habitable zone. And we also have to save so I don't have to deal with that again. Okay. So now I have to remember exactly where that room with the frozen Viking was. There was also the NPC who was frozen, who we passed by, who is now unfrozen, and he is actually the blacksmith. So, for the first time, we're going to have the ability to upgrade our weapons once we get to him. He'll also repair your stuff, but that's for later, because he can't actually do that until he goes back to his workshop. Here he is. Here is the boss. He is carrying... That weapon that he's carrying is the Icon of Ice. Holy shit, I've never seen him do that! Okay, he's starting this off with new attacks. It's two attacks now that I've never seen him use. Oh, wow. The fuck is this boss even doing? Okay, so we're about to have to learn this one on the fly. So far, not bad. If he wants to keep using the ice breath, hey, there's something familiar. There's something else familiar. Usually what I get him to do a lot is, like, it's a little whirlwind spinning attack he does. Okay, never seen him use the ice breath, never seen him do the shockwave. Oh, shit. Suddenly this becomes a very dangerous boss fight. Not knowing what he's gonna do. Ooh, hey! There's some familiar territory to tread. It's like late into the boss fight, after he's already done a bunch of kind of scary new stuff. Yeah, he's not giving that thing up without a fight. There we go. We got the Icon of Ice. Now that we have that, we have to once again backtrack all the way back to the altar. And we have to place the icon upon it. Kind of like what we did with the altar and the Icon of Healing. will about be it for us. I think the room right ahead is where the dwarf melted out, the blacksmith. Hey, buddy. The Viking motif here. Like it. I wish it was just a dream. I'll be returning to my quarters now. Please stop by later. We'll be doing that momentarily. I think once we leave this area or zone out, he'll just kind of teleport there. Okay, so that's the dialogue that we needed to trigger from him, so he'll teleport eventually. Make his way back to his smith. And then, is there anything else I'm missing here? Well, I mean, I'll have one more trip to make back into this area later on to collect all the stuff that I missed the first two passes through. But I'm trying to think if there's something that I can't grab later that I can grab now. And I don't think there's anything like that, fortunately. There's nothing that you can't grab when it's frozen over, and there's nothing that you can't grab at this stage. Once again, I think. So the path back is what? Following that little stream? Yeah, because this is the central forge. This is the kiln. This is the room with the shield, I want to say. Yeah. It was the room with the chest that had the shield in it. So this, wait. Yeah, okay. There is something that I can grab really easily right now. Oh, hey. Whoa, fuck. Oh. Nope, I'm getting out of here. I'll do that later. That's a lot of poison suddenly. I forgot they could even poison you. Actually, completely forgot about that. And I don't have any antidotes left, do I? Yeah, the forest root cures everything with the exception of poison. So, dried amphibia, just gonna eat that lizard like it's Shadow of the Colossus. That's okay, though. One thing I'm probably gonna do off camera is make a supply run to one of the merchants, because I'm not sure if the blacksmith actually sells anything. But if he does, that'll be convenient. Either way, I'm gonna make an off-screen trip to one of the merchants and actually spend some of this money that I've been building up, and also sell off a couple of things that are just clogging up the inventory for no good reason. Good. The dragonkin are behaving, I think. Come on. Okay. Yeah, all the dinosaurs around here all behaving pretty nicely. I don't think they can shoot fireballs at you through the window here. Where is that? I think I passed it by. Uh-oh. This is why I need to take a trip to the merchant and do some organizing, at least. Ah, great. So, we've cooled things down now. Or rather, we've slowed the flow of lava. We haven't completely stopped it like the smelter demon did, but we've calmed it down a little bit. So, the forge is now as navigable as it's gonna get. We've essentially completed that area. Aside from just going in and collecting optional equipment. Of which there's some pretty good stuff in there. Also, the frame rate just chug-a-lugged. Chug-a-lug-lug. Yeah, it's worth scouring the forge because there's a lot of really good stuff in there. Including one of the best swords in the game, I think. Certainly a top contender. And it's especially serendipitous because we just unlocked the first NPC who can actually upgrade our equipment. There is a natural way to upgrade stuff, but then there's also the much simpler route of just getting the smith to upgrade your stuff for you. You do upgrade your weapons naturally over time just through use. I think it's like 200 or 100 strikes to get it to plus one. And that stacks on top of what you can get with the blacksmith. So it's not like you're paying him just to expedite upgrading. There are the blacksmith upgrades alongside those natural ones. Get the shit down here, are you kidding? They have a nice design, nice visual design with the way the gradient pattern on their wings makes it look kind of nice and translucent. I believe I want to drop here. Yeah. While I'm not being harassed by pill bugs. And then you follow this around, and there should be a drop for a chest. This is actually one of the trickier chests to locate. Actually feels like a soul's chest in that way. Like the way that this is hidden. Yeah. Oh, there's a nice suit of armor here. This is a really cool design. This is like my favorite type of chest armor in the game. Just for looks. And I think I'm going to save scouring this for... I don't know if I'm going to do it off camera or if I'm going to do like a Bloodborne style intermission video that's just a quick cut of some item locations, or if I'll just do that like picture in picture in the next episode. But that's gonna do it for now. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.